today.
Talk a little bit about supergeometry today, and I will start with giving you an instant course in super manifolds. So of course I need many details. Now I'm going to talk only about non-singular super manifolds, not because I just don't need anything else, but because it's really not completely. It's kind of very interesting question. But can you study singularities in supergroups? What is it? I don't think much of anything actually. What kind of
when you say singularity, you mean singularity in the odd direction?
Yeah. So first let us decide what is an affine space, AMF. So this is the usual affine space here. And the shape of functions. Just see functions on it. A free superalgebra, free commutative superalgebra with m even variables, and then odd. And so traditionally, so we work over a field of characteristic zero.
Category of supermanifolds.
I'm going to talk about it in a minute. Give me a minute, okay? So what variables? Are necessarily important. So in particular, I am now going to define this as an ideal, as a shift ideal, if you want. Is generated, this is the ideal generated by, if I take all G, take an odd part and generate an ideal. Okay? So this ideal is necessarily important because any odd is important, any odd element.
What's
OG? What's OG? So OG has a gradient. I pick up odd elements and generate ideal by them.
Well, what is G?
OX. Okay. And so this is the shape of what you this is the ideal which defines the subvariety.
Which
one? X0. So in fact, for any super manifold X, I can associate super X.
Excuse me, are you sure you want to call it the nilpotent ideal Ix0? You want to call it like that? You wrote Ix0 equal Ox1.
No, it's an ideal. That's what.
No, no,
ideal Ix1. Generated by.
That's, yeah, but you call it Ix0. You want to call it with a 0? Okay.
Z. You want to call it
fine.
Z?
Fine.
No, the 0.
Okay.
The
zero is a kind of, because it looks like even, but it's okay. No, it's okay. You just leave it.
No, but yeah, that's the point.
It's a deceiving name, but okay.
It's not silly.
Huh?
No? It's the ideal of some manifold and zero.
Okay.
It's an ideal of X0.
Okay.
That's the point. So here what I mean, I take the whole structure shift, pick up one part, take the ideal generated by all elements,
okay.
And that will be exactly the ideal of this sub-manifold or sub-variety. You
okay.
Can work in any category, algebraic, analytic.
Yes, yes. Sorry.
So what is this? This is X0. And then the shift, which is a shift of sections of the bundle, vector bundle, which is an exterior algebra of the normal bundle. Okay. And it's actually greater because if you take this shift here, and this is an exercise, if you take all of X, so this ideal defines the filtration, and the gradient will give you this. Okay, so X supermanifold X is called split. If it is isomorphic to its group. And in a smooth category, in the category of smooth manifolds, actually any algebraic, any smooth manifold is split, but in the category of algebraic, it is not. Let me just talk about
example. Yeah. For this, psi 1, psi 2, you know upstairs.
No,
so you have coordinate change with
He wants me to tell you something. He wants to tell you, but locally you always have splitting. But when you do gluing, the splitting is not preserved. And the question is if you can make the change of variable such that the splitting is preserved, if this is always possible to do, and the answer is no. But the first example exercise would be the split manifold. So if you have one dimensional manifold, and this is what I'm going to give you, this is P11. So how you can think about it? It is one zero-dimensional spaces, subspaces in K, K10, subspace in K21. So non-homogeneous coordinates, I have two. In homogeneous coordinates, I have two even coordinates and one over. So I have a basis in 1 and 2 here, and the 3, and this one is over. And so that gives you the log variable. And when I do local coordinates, I can make one of them 1, so I can coordinate 1. And this is going to give me one well, and then I'm going to have another coordinate. So what I can do, I can multiply by x and y's, and then I go y, 1, z, and so y is equal to x and y's, and z is equal to x and y's. And so, now, this manifold is necessarily split because my gluing function still preserves parity, and so you can check easily in this formula that P11 is P1 as an underlying manifold, and the shape is going to be OP1. The shape OX is usual manifold is usual manifold shape plus. Y means that the another part is odd. O of minus 1. So now we are going to move to algebraic groups. Algebraic supergroups.
Exercise. I want to make sure I understand. So P1 the topological space, then you have OP1 is the sheaf plus the parity change.
OP1
minus 1. Okay, so when you write OP1, you mean OP1, you mean? I'm not sure I understand, sorry.
O on P1 is just the structure sheaf on P1.
Okay.
The sheaf of
okay,
functors
perfect.
On
P1. Okay. Sheaf of, okay.
So we have this functor,
which is a sheaf.
So no, but whether I don't.
It's probably a shift or super.
Yeah, whether I don't shift, I put x downstairs, right? And what is this? This is a global section of this shift, if you want. Okay?
It's global.
Yeah, global section. But we are in a fine situation. So it really doesn't matter. And the functor is, of course, a formula. This is a whole algebra. So, G of A. Are homomorphic. This whole algebra. So A is my supercomputer. And this made a group could be made into a group because we have homomorphic. So you can multiply yourself. Homomorphic, right?
What does it mean, geometry? Does it enumerate methods into G?
Yeah, if you want, you take zero M dimensional varieties and you consider it fine. Here I don't want to spend too much time on it, but I would like to give you two exercises. Oh yeah, before I do this, of course, I can define now the ideal generated by all odd elements. It's going to be half ideal. And when I take the quotient, half, I get a half algebra corresponding to GC. So I just say it verbally because it more or less works like this plus like it worked before, like here, only now you have additional condition that you have half ideal.
Can you say that G0 is a usual group?
Yes, that's basically what I'm saying. So maybe I just put it here and check. As an exercise. Another exercise.
G is a usual algebra.
Usual? G zero. And I take the quotient algebra. So I'm going to give you the functor GLM. And I'm going to construct you the group. This would be the group of matrices. This I would be beautiful I, and this would be the usual. We have two more conditions. A and D must be invertible. Which is equivalent to say that the determinant of A and the determinant of A and the determinant of G are invertible in A0. And so the question is, show that. I'm constructing a functor now. Functor from supercommutative rings to groups. Show that whichever map and A is representable. Minimum construct corresponds to functor, not here. Example is the example of Casella map, so let me briefly formulate the exercise concerning this example.
Of superalgebra, of course, right?
Mm-hmm. You know, I sometimes forget to say super.
Right.
But you should remember that I'm a superwoman and everything is super. So example three exercise. Let us consider the morphism of functors now from GLM to GL1. Which is called the Deligne. And which is defined as Schur-Weyl and the Deligne of A, B, C, D. Is the determinant of A, minus B, D over C, divided by determinant. So it's called defined because both A and D are not. So how to guess this formula? So what you have to check, but this is the homomorphism of groups.
What does it mean?
It's multiplicity.
No, no, what does it mean? The division of A, B, C, D. What does A, B, C, D? See what the functor
No, yeah. We already have this functor and this functor, and then this is morphism of functor. Right?
Yes.
That's perfect sense. Now check that we did it. And so here I want to say, we can't tell you that you can do it. It also becomes clear why such formula appeared. I have to be very careful, so right? A is B as a product of A prime is a known thing here as well as X and Y, but those guys are old, remember, right? A prime B 0. So if I want to construct an analog of determinant.
Yeah, D prime.
Not D.
Or A prime.
Yes, A prime. So if you want to construct such a formula, then it's pretty clear when you want the division of this guy and this guy to be 1. And since you should remember that actually the division comes from super trace, here I should have the ratio of two determinants. So find A prime and supply and you get this formula. And you also can use this decomposition form of expectivity. And so, Deligne equals 1 gives me a supergroup of A. Which is denoted by SLM. So now, of course, just using the sign rule, I can define the least superalgebra of an algebraic supergroup.
It's easy. If you define a cell in that way, shouldn't you prove representability?
Yes, you have. Yeah. I don't want to spend time on it.
No. I'm just saying one should.
One
not
should,
that you should
right,
do.
Representability, of course. Yeah.
Can you describe what is X0 or GL or SL?
Underlying groups, let's figure them out. So in this case, G0 plus GLM cross GL. Here you can
of a certain subgroup, right? Such a determinant of this matrix equals a determinant. So Deligne is by definition a superalgebra. Derivation, super derivation. And as in the usual case, it can be identified. Point derivation is identified. So of course, next exercise, if you never did it, check a few of the element. You guess what? A few of a element also all. Representation theory of supergroups and all this. But we are going now to concentrate on the question how you do better. If I have a superalgebra, can I construct a supergroup corresponding to this algebra? Then I'm going to do it for algebraic case. So this theorem should put a lot of names into it, so it's possible.
What is out G1? G1.
Your question is what? So I say that there is a representation such, but if I take its derivative.
But G1 is not an algebra.
Automorphisms.
Here automorphisms and here endomorphisms.
It's
just a brain.
Here, the problem should be
closed. Here.
Huh?
It should be faceful.
Oh, no.
G0.
No. Nothing is faithful.
From this residual supergroup,
yeah.
such that it's given part.
Oh yes, sorry, of course. Such that.
Of G is equal to G, not G0.
It's G.
And G reduced.
No point used.
No, you know G0 equals G. G0 equals to G reduced.
Ah.
So
it's really
fast.
Okay. Well,
anyway,
it's not
that
clear.
G0 equals G0.
Yes.
It's a kind of crash of notation.
Crisis of notation. Sorry. But it's clear now.
Yes.
So what you should do, you just have to point you from your G0 from the regular representation of G0 which you have. So the reason for this theorem is actually quite simple. Morally, it's a very simple theorem because you see all these odd directions are formal directions. Okay? So you can always integrate in odd directions. Exercise of start. Exercise of start. Define. So product, antipod, and co-unit in this way. So if you want really to do the exercise, you should know what is probably a little bit. It's not complete, it's not trivial. Yeah. And so, but this theorem actually implies another important theory that if you want to study representations of algebraic group, we can do the same as we do with Kazhdan-Lusztig-Brundan modules, where G0 is integrable. So you look at representation integrable of G0, so there is an equivalence of categories, representations of G0. With equivalence, category of G0 modules.
You probably mean finite dimensional.
No, but I think people should do what is it. I think you can figure out what is a representation. Co module over co algebra, for example. I mean, you just, actually, if you take Janssen book on algebraic group and put super everywhere, it's going to work. It's not a big deal.
G0 module, you mean locally finite?
Yeah. What are G0 modules? Those are exactly a pair, right? G module. N G zero module, such that they deal G zero. If you want, yes, you can say just G module, which will be integrated to representation of G. Yeah.
Algebraic.
In three-dimensional representation, you need some topology.
No, right now I'm talking about algebraic groups, okay? Algebraic supergroups. I consider category of algebraic supergroups. Everything is algebraic.
If you have three-dimensional supergroups, the out of the group is algebraic group.
Okay. Okay, so let's say this works in finite dimensional. It's really some technical. You take int. Every representation of algebraic group is an int object. Okay.
This is what.
That's what I said.
Okay. Okay. So what I'm saying, any representation of an algebraic supergroup. Directly limit of finite dimensional representation. So do it on finite dimensional, go to directly. Okay? Actually, I'm going to talk later about finite dimensional representation. Maybe this discussion is not so important whatsoever, actually. So now I want to concentrate on a specific case, the case when G0 is reductive. G0 is reductive. The category of G0 is semi-simple, right? It's of the dark group.
I'm sorry, I missed it when I was writing.
What is L?
P.
L.
P.
L. Projective cover.
Assuming the quotient is affine?
No.
No.
Not at all. No.
Okay.
The it's crucial that it is not a prime. We are not going to classify functions.
But in which sense you write O, G?
These are sections again. When I write shape, I put it here.
Okay.
But the global section may be just constant, right?
So if A was a finite dimensional representation, then you can consider something like G over HM. And that gives me vector bundle. G divided. And again, if you want to see how to prove all this, look at the answer and put superalgebra. So you can define the sections of this bundle. This is my notation. Might be a little bit strange, but these are again. M, invariant for action of H here on the right and here on the left. Okay, and the usual way.
Don't you need to put M star?
Now is under additional assumption.
study this factor. So now we take GB weighting. So I'm going to study this functor, and there is no problem because it's going to be finite dimensional. So Ilya is, of course, right, but in general I can have some infinite dimensional representation, but I'm going to now study it under assumption of a basic supergroup. And U is a parabolic subgroup. Which is defined from the definition of parabolic subalgebra. And parabolic subalgebra, sometimes it is Borel, right? Sometimes it is Borel. Borel is division of positive and negative roots. And if you move your plane such that some roots are on the hyperplane, then it is, so Q contains some Borel. And it has the V subalgebra, so Q is an unusual case, is the semi-direct product of V subgroup and some nilpotent subgroup, which is zero. In particular, important case is when Q plus V and the V is a Borel subalgebra. And in this case, B is the product of maximum torus such that the B algebra is the group N plus. So let me remind, by the way, that in characteristic zero, we have equivalence between nilpotent algebraic, connected nilpotent algebraic groups and B algebras. And that, of course, goes through for supergroups as well. And I want to give you one example. So if we take G to be general linear group, what we are going to get is some partial flux varieties, right? So the same is in supercase. And when we consider G mod Q, so what you're going to do, you're going
to pick out some affine chart. For example, you can make this one, this one, this zero, and this zero. So one of affine charts.
So now we have learned
P. Well, it defines one-dimensional representation of P. Because you remember, B is an important normal subgroup, semi-direct product of vectorals, so these are one-dimensional representation of P. So theorem is the following. Let lambda be typical in the definition as before, right? It's here. Let lambda be typical. So if lambda plus rho is not regular, or maybe, you know what? Can I make a I would like to change annotation. Let's call this latest lambda, big lambda. Sorry. So if lambda plus rho has a non-trivial stabilizer, in the even usual wild group, then gamma I j mod e. C gamma is 0, or 1. Now we assume that lambda plus rho is regular. This is the first case. Lambda plus rho is regular.
Want mu is dominant with respect to B, right? What does it mean to respect to W? I'm confused, sorry.
I'm trying to down it now.
Exactly, yeah.
if you let me just talk about the proof. I'm going to explain a little bit about the proof. So this theorem has two parts. In the first part, we assume that lambda itself is non-enough. It's already in lambda plus. Okay? And then you can check, really, we can check, that gamma 0 j mod p c lambda is a maximal finite dimensional quotient. So it's actually k lambda, if you remember, first module. I remind you that this is maximal finite dimensional quotient of your mama. So how you prove this? Okay, you localize and take one open chart in the Grassmannian, as I did before, and check that regular functions there is exactly dual to the Lerman module. And then that basically applies this. Now if lambda is typical, there is no extensions, there is no other submodules there, right? So then KB lambda equals LB lambda, as we discussed before for typical representations. And at least we know gamma zero part. Now, the second part is actually to prove vanishing of other cohomologies, right? So here, what Penkov did in his dissertation, he mimics the Mazur proof.
Alpha double shift.
I hope. So when you say invert in sum, usually invert in sum, it means that you consider an open subset.
What did I say inverting? I did not say inverting in any more. No, okay. So this is a relation that H0 for P1, it's H0 P1 of O of M is isomorphic to H1 of P1 of O of minus N minus P. Okay? So you perform this thing on fiber and use the wave spectrum sequence to prove it for a homology like this. And this part goes exactly the same way in the super case when you use your even reflection, but you need these odd reflections as well. Because, so what is the point of the proof? You start with Borel and you go to the opposite Borel. And when you get homology only in the top degree there, and going back, that means, say, for a dominant weight, you have only sections and nothing else. So you want to do the same in the super case. But the point is, you cannot go to the opposite Borel just using even reflection. You have to use odd reflections, reflections with the isotropic root.
So are you using step one when the k becomes zero for many weights?
If lambda is lambda plus, k is not zero.
But now you're using the fact that it's going to be zero if lambda is not. Is it only a good?
Not exactly, no. I'm saying I know zero cohomology for the dominant weight, and therefore I can calculate top cohomology. Because this is one-to-one correspondence, cohomology can grow, we can calculate top cohomology for the opposite body, for the anti-dominant way. So you figure out that for anti-dominant way, you can cohomology only in the top degree and you cover.
Why only?
Oh, because it goes like this, right? And you know that there is no cohomology bigger than the dimension. Or there's no negative cohomology if you want. So it's really enough. Well, so I just want to say very briefly what is happening in the super case. And as I say, going from applying the longest element W0 and W is only possible if you involve odd reflection.
Here I use the fact that my
weight is really typical because under glass door with alpha, I assume at this moment that this is not zero, and this is only true if the weight is typical. But when I have implied even reflections, so like odd, even, odd, in the end, I do the same. So the problem, open problem. I still don't know gamma I, g mod b, c lambda, for atypical lambda. So there is a way to understand this, if you understand very well what happens if the reflection is typical and if it equals zero here, you actually probably could understand this whole situation. But it's still open question. And what is interesting that...
You mean for SL11?
Yeah, there is a sort of... Okay, I don't have time to concentrate on this right now, but the point is that I have to, when I go, when I do push forward, I have a filtration by push two invertible shifts here and a switch, the filtration switch. So maybe I should say something briefly. V1 of lambda, I have the filtration, I just call it A and B. And when I want to do P2, coming from another plug, and it's going to be the switch of filtration. But it's not, this is on at the level of shifts. Okay, so I have two-dimensional bundle, on G mod P, and I have the switch of filtration. It's not completely clear what it does with cohomology. So, because of this, this is still an open problem, and there are some funny things happening. Some cohomology jump. So now I would like to apply all this to representation theory.
The work by Pankow has been published, doesn't it? The one about the Borel-Weil-Bott.
It's his PhD thesis, actually.
Huh?
It's his PhD thesis.
Oh, but it did not get published as paper, I mean.
Yeah, it's published somewhere. Some Russian.
I know, in Russian, I know. Yeah. I was asking if there is an English.
No, but usually it's translated.
I think yes. Yes,
okay,
there is a translation.
Sure.
And I have a club reference. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to introduce the following thing. So I'm going to take gamma I, G mod V, C lambda, defined as before. And this is
have to reply. It's easy to show. It could have moved one under the dimension of the okay? And I'm saying that I know this thing. Although I don't know how rich component looks like, I know the character for the Weyl characteristic, and what do you think it is? It is this formula. Since now I fix P, I don't put rho equals something. So you should recognize it, right? It's the same while Kazhdan-Lusztig-Brundan formula as we discussed before in lecture number 2.
And this for any lambda.
And this works for any lambda. I'm going, and even you have another analog of this for G mod Q, but Q is any parabolic. So let me write it down also. Exactly. This formula works for typical lambda, right? So for example, this is a geometric proof in any type of this formula. Because we proved that cohomology appears only in 1 degree. So
what was the other side of the
formula? It was for typical lambda. It's not just character of a lambda. So it's exactly the formula. So, by some applications, it's kind of important to do it for G mod Q, but Q is an arbitrary parabolic. And actually, and here I can put actually any M module Q over Q, finite-dimensional Q module.
Yeah, should be K from the.
Typical, it's the same.
All of them that equals K.
For typical case, yes. So, this is also a nice formula.
Can you repeat? What is delta 1 plus L? I'm sorry, I couldn't
okay.
get it.
L is the piece of room.
Okay.
And therefore it is, it has roots.
Okay, okay. It's the lady.
Idea of
proof.
Since it's a little bit, I'm running a little bit out of time, I put as an exercise, I mean, not running out of time, but what I want to say. I
I have no idea how to calculate this cohomology. But what I can go to the grr of mine. So I'm looking at grr of G. And then it has a filtration. Let us say do this case. And then I can also now all lambda becomes a certain. It's going to be G0 divided. And when I start calculating cohomology, because calculating cohomology is actually the even part. Of course, some things are cancelled if I have a filtration, but for Euler characteristic, it doesn't matter. So the Euler characteristic remains the same.
So O lambda, here are global sections of, what is it? Is what is
sections,
gamma? Is gamma, right?
It's sections of it, line bundle.
I know, but it's what you called before, maybe gamma was? Gamma of G mod V?
It's a shift.
I am aware it's a shift.
A shift of sections.
Is the one that gives you gamma, right?
Yeah, exactly. Shift of sections. Yeah, sure. Coming from C lambda. Yeah.
Right.
Right. Okay, so well, I can do it. I can do it. It's not so difficult. Let me write down the formula. What you have to do, you have to take S of the conormal bundle.
Grr as like an ordinary manifold with this vector bundle.
Well,
that's what you're
bundle
doing.
Plus is going to be G 0 to 1.
Ah, well, that's like the trick. I see.
Another for time lambda. And then by time lambda, I mean the typical weight lambda integral dominant, a typical weight such that lambda plus mu, and I pick up this maximal antiquality set of isotropic roots, as I explained before. And weight is called tame if they could be made all simple for somebody.
Can you repeat the conjecture just?
The conjecture is that if lambda is tame, okay. Now I should go quicker than I wanted to.
So, and this is the Fuhlmann situation. Let us consider the correct integrating of the representation. So it has a basis. Given by the classes, it's an integrand group given by the classes of all irreducible representations. So we can now define a new class E lambda as this Euler characteristic class. So it's actually can be a negative. It's a virtual. So the character of this thing I know, so it's kind of very important to calculate multiplicity. The E stands for early characteristic. Now this is exactly this thing over here. So here's those idle characters of them. So it's kind of important, of course, to understand. So in principle it is possible to do using different methods. And then at least we have some trying to get some algorithm calculation of the Now I would like to formulate without proof one result, my recent result proof, not so recent, but result in collaboration with Karolin Gruzon, which of course should be proven earlier. And this is a weak PJG reciprocity. Going to formulate it. It's the following thing. Let lambda plus be a dominant wild chambers before. And lambda dom is actually something different. If you recall, this is the set of all weights lambda, such that L lambda is finite dimension. So as I explained to you before, there are two different conditions, right? I was trying to explain it in lecture two when I explained how weights, which weights are integral. Those are actually two different, generally speaking, set of parameters.
Which is large?
This is large.
El contrato, sí.
And,
sí,
y mío,
You mean linear?
And P mu can be written as P mu C. Yes. P mu is a projective power. And I should take the value. So I have two matrices, infinite matrices, A lambda mu and B mu lambda, where of course comes.
This sounds like infinite.
Huh?
This sum is infinite.
This sum is
infinite.
No, finite. This one is finite.
Ah, because it's
it's finite sum. So in principle, what you want to do? You want to take calculate A lambda mu and invert the matrix. And then it invert. If I want to calculate character of a mu, and I know how to calculate characters of A lambda, I should take this matrix A lambda mu, which is upper triangular in many cases. There are some technicalities there, which I'm swiping under the rug. And then I can invert it, because it's only unipotent matrix, and I can write down a formula. And the formula for a character of A mu will involve infinitely many terms. So I'm going to discuss how to calculate these coefficients next time. And I have 5 minutes, and I very briefly want to discuss D modules, okay? So maybe I take 2 minutes. So the D modules over G mod D are actually the whole fact, which makes it in a way not so interesting, that dx for a super manifold, dx, the category of dx modules, is equivalent to the category of dx zero module on the underlying usual variety. Let us check this in the case when x zero is a point. That what R, D, and so X is then 0 and dimensional. Okay? So then what are these DXs? Those are differential operators of the Grassmann algebra. But this is nothing else as a matrix ring. So similarly, locally, matrix ring of size 2n, 2 to the power n, okay? The matrix ring. Because differential operators are just all linear operators on the finite, except we're talking about local linear differential operators.
So, how would you define differential operators?
As usual. There is a prototype, for example, definition of differential operator Q any algebra commutative algebra. You can do it for supercommutative algebra as well. In the same way, it exists locally. For suitable U, I do have, in general, D of U would be the matrix algebra. With coefficients in D of U0. And to prove this theorem in general, there is this result of Kazhdan-Lusztig-Brundan result, that if you have a closed non-singular subvariety, then the D modules will support on this subvariety. So what you do, you consider a theorem inside X, and you have a functor which is the push forward, right? Extension, Kazhdan extension functor. So in this case, it always gives you equivalence of particles. In Kazhdan case, this is a subcategory of D modules with support on the subvariety. But here the notion of support coincides with the whole thing, so it's not so terribly interesting. In our case, it just gives an equivalence, dx mod. If I would be able to define something like a singular even subvariety, then I might get something interesting. But right now I don't. There is no interest in geometry with D modules. So talking about dierent and Stein localization.
For the notation, so the D lambda are the differential operators on the sections of the bundle.
Lambda is an integral of those differential operator with sections in the corresponding line one. If lambda is not integral, there is a definition of TDO.
No, it's very clear what it is. Mm-hmm.
So what fails for a typical? Actually the first step, because what we usually have, we always have a homomorphism of algebra, reduced algebra model central character, to the global section of D lambda. is an isomorphism in typical case. But if so, it's an isomorphism in typical. But then how is atypical? Let's go there. Gamma. If it is atypical, then this gamma has kernel and kernel at the level of global sections. So I can surely say what lies in the kernel of this map. Because if guys are typical, it's not very difficult to see that this algebra has a non-zero set of some radical. So one would like to name caution by it. So this is the project I kept in mind. However, there is a difficult point there, so I never finished it. So let's caution by this critical. Thank you.